Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Today we are going to discuss another important topic, that is shock. And this will be the last topic of this unit, the hemodynamics. When we talk about the definition of the shock, it is the state in which decreased cardiac output or circulating blood volume, it impairs the tissue perfusion and leads to cellular hypoxia. There are various causes of decreased cardiac output or decreased circulating blood volume. For example, there may be severe hemorrhage, trauma, burn, and another important cause is the septicemia. So these are the few important causes which can lead to the formation of a shock-like condition. We'll discuss the important stages of the shock today and the general categories in which the shock is divided. If we talk about the general categories of shock, they are cardiogenic shock, hypovolemic shock, and the shock associated with systemic inflammation. This shock that is associated with systemic inflammation, it is also called as septic shock. If we talk about the cardiogenic shock and the hypovolemic shock, both of them, they may result from decreased cardiac output. But the etiologies, they are different in both of these categories. For example, in case of cardiogenic shock, the main defect, it lies at the level of heart. For example, various conditions that affect the heart, they may result in the development of cardiogenic shock. We can add some arrhythmias, especially the ventricular arrhythmias, which may result in decreased pumping of the blood. Similarly, myocardial infarction, another important cause of the cardiogenic shock. Some obstruction to the outflow, like pulmonary embolism, that can cause cardiogenic shock. Similarly, cardiac tamponade that we studied in the pulmonary thromboembolism, that is also an important cause of cardiogenic shock. If we talk about the hypovolemic shock, it is also associated with decreased cardiac output, but that decreased cardiac output, it may be due to low blood volume. And that low blood volume, it may be due to number of disorders. For example, there may be some extensive trauma that may result in excessive blood loss. For example, some fracture or accident which may result in acute blood loss from any part of the body. Similarly, acute gastroenteritis, which may cause severe deficiency of salt and water, again that can cause hypovolemic shock. Another important condition is extensive burns or the severe burns that may also result in the development of hypovolemic shock. If we talk about the shock associated with systemic inflammation or the septic shock, it may be triggered by numerous inflammatory responses. For example, there may be gram-negative septicemia, there may be pancreatitis. Similarly, if we talk about the severe burns, that may also be associated with infection, and that infection, it can also lead to this septic shock. So these are the various important causes of these three categories of the shock. With the passage of time, when you people will go to the clinical classes and clinical rotation, you people will come across more and more conditions that may result in development of the shock or shock like condition. This table, it sums up the three generalized categories of the shock, their examples, and the principal mechanism. The principal mechanisms that are involved in the cardiogenic shock, they may differ from condition to condition. Well, in the case of hypovolemic shock, almost always the main principal mechanism is the depletion in the plasma volume or the blood volume. Well, if we talk about the septic shock, we'll study its mechanism or its pathogenesis in detail in the coming slides. If we talk about the septic shock, bacterial infections are most often involved in any type of the septic shock. But sepsis, it can result from various other infection. It may result from viruses, it may result from some life-threatening fungal infection. Septicemia, it can arise as a result of some major trauma, or it can even arise from a small needle stick injury to any part of the body, especially the areas that are surrounding the joints.
or it may result from severe burns that are followed by the infections. It may result from some inflammation that may convert it into systemic inflammation, like it may be associated with appendicitis, pneumonia, that is the inflammation of lung parenchyma. It may get associated with the meningitis, in which there is a spread of bacteria to the blood, or it may result from urinary tract infection. So if there is any infection that can cause a risk of spread, that may result in the development of septic shock. A very common form of the bone infection that is called as osteomyelitis, that is also associated with development of septic shock. So in people who are hospitalized, the bacteria that trigger the sepsis, they can enter the blood through the IV lines, through the drip sets, through the catheters like urinary catheters. And another important source of infection in the hospitalized patient, that is the bed sores that usually develop in the old age people who remain in some certain specific condition for a long period of time. So anyone can get this septic shock, but certain group of the peoples, they are at greater risk. For example, those people who have decreased immune system or who are immunocompromised, they are at increased risk. For example, the patients of HIV AIDS, or a patient who is having any kind of cancer, or a patient who is suffering from diabetes mellitus. Again, the immune system that is not that much strong in these patients. Similarly, some patients who are taking immunosuppressive drugs, they are also at risk of developing this septic shock. A very important immunosuppressive drug is steroid, that is usually given in numerous cases of the transplant to prevent the rejection of the transplanted organ. Similarly, numerous other drugs, methotrexate, chlorambucil, chemotherapeutic drugs, they can result in the development of septic shock. Similarly, neonates, they are also at increased risk of developing septic shock as a result of some minor infection or minor injury to the body. So here I mention a point, neonates, and now I mention a point, the elderly people. So extremes of ages, both of these groups, they are at risk of developing septic shock as a result of some inflammation. People having diabetes, I have already mentioned previously that they are also at risk of developing the septic shock. You people must have studied in the inflammation that numerous cells of inflammation, they are involved, like macrophages, like neutrophils, like dendritic cells. So all these inflammatory cells, they are also involved in the pathogenesis of this septic shock.
If we talk about the various pathogenetic mechanism of the septic shocks, usually we have 4 or 5 mechanisms that are involved in the pathogenesis of septic shock. Top of the list being the inflammatory and the counter-inflammatory responses, that is also called as systemic inflammatory response syndrome. Then there comes the endothelial injury and endothelial cell activation. You people have studied in detail throughout this topic of hemodynamics. Then there is an induction of the procoagulant state. We have studied it previously on many occasions. Few metabolic abnormalities, they can result in development of septic shock. Like we have a very common example of this diabetes mellitus, and organ dysfunction that can also result in the development of septic shock. Now we will discuss these mechanisms or these abnormalities one by one. Starting off with the systemic inflammatory response syndrome. This is a very important picture that is being displayed on your computer screens. Many factors, they have been postulated to trigger the onset of this septic shock that is related to inflammation. And one of the very important factor that is involved in this pathogenesis of septic shock, that is the bacterial lipopolysaccharides. These bacterial lipopolysaccharide, as well as the products from the damaged cells, which are released after ischemia reperfusion injury or after blunt trauma in which there is no infectious agent, so that can result in the as that can result as an inciting agent. One very important receptor that is involved, that is called as toll-like receptor 4, and this toll-like receptor 4, it leads to the production of inflammatory mediators, and it has been suggested to play a key role in the pathogenesis of this septic shock. Liposaccharide from the gram-negative bacteria, they react with the toll-like receptor 4 to cause the phagocytic cells to generate a variety of pro-inflammatory cytokines. And these pro-inflammatory cytokines, they include this interleukin-1, interleukin-6, and interleukin-10. Along with these pro-inflammatory cytokines, various reactive oxygen species, they may also be generated, and they can further cause the cell injury. There is one speculation that gram-negative bacteria in the gut may gain access to the circulation during the septic shock, releasing lipopolysaccharide, and this lipopolysaccharide then reacts with the or then get attached to the toll-like receptor 4, and leading to all this systemic inflammatory response syndrome or the inflammatory response that is present in the septic shock. It is also clear that we have inadequate knowledge. Very important thing about pathology is that wherever we do not know something clearly, we just add a line that it is also clear that we do not know much clearly about the whole of the pathogenetic mechanism of this septic shock. The complement pathway or the complement cascade, you people will study in the coming chapter of immunology, that is also activated by various bacterial products, and there are two complement pathways, direct pathway and the indirect pathway. And the activation of the complement pathway, it again leads to the various products that ultimately have various function. For example, one very important product is C5A, that is called as anaphylatoxin. And C5A, it is also a very important chemotactic factor. Similarly, C3B, that is also that causes opsonization of bacteria, that is also important. So various factors are secreted due to activation of the complement pathway, which further aggravates the condition. And similarly, you can see in the picture that one of the very important coagulation factor that is also involved, and that is the coagulation factor 12. And indirectly, it is also result in the or it is also produced as a result of this endothelial dysfunction. So when there is endothelial dysfunction and there is generation of this coagulation factor 12, it may result in the activation of the thrombin, and this thrombin activation, it further produces inflammation. And as you remember, you people must remember a very important enzyme that is called as protease activated receptor, that is also involved, and this protease activated receptor, it triggers the inflammation or the inflammatory cells. The second important pathogenetic mechanism that was involved in the septic shock, that was the endothelial cell dysfunction or the endothelial cell injury and its activation. Various pro-inflammatory mediators and the endothelial cell injury that may result in generation of various inflammatory cytokines or pro-inflammatory cytokines and reactive oxygen species, and these pro-inflammatory cytokines and reactive oxygen species, they tend to loosen the endothelial cells tight junction. When the tight junction between the endothelial cells, they are loose, it will result in leakage of the capillary fluid or the fluid from the blood vessels. So when the fluid is lost from the blood vessel, when the plasma rich fluid is lost from the blood vessel, it will cause accumulation of the fluid in the extracellular compartment, that is the interstitial compartment, while the intravascular fluid, that will be decreased. As a result of decrease in the intravascular fluid, the blood pressure of the patient will fall. The endothelial cell injury, it will also result in the generation of the nitric oxide and other inflammatory mediators which affect the blood vessels. So these inflammatory mediators and the nitric oxide, it will result in the dilatation of the blood vessels. When the blood vessels, they are dilated, again the blood will pool up in the blood will pool up, and there will be a circulatory collapse, ultimately worsening the blood pressure. And when there is decrease in the blood pressure, the patient will experience the shock like conditions. So this was the second mechanism that involves the endothelial cell injury and the activation. The third important factor or the pathogenetic mechanism, that is the involvement of the or induction of the procoagulant state. When we talk about the procoagulant state, that is always associated with the endothelial cell injury or the endothelial cell activation. This injury to the endothelium, it may result activation of the various procoagulant factor, one of the very important one being the tissue factor. And alongside the activation of the procoagulant factor, it will also result in increased generation of the antifibrinolytic factor, that is called as plasminogen activator inhibitor. Now remember that on one side there is activation of these tissue factor and the plasminogen activator inhibitor, and on the other side there is generalized vasodilation in the stasis and the pulling up of the blood. So both of these mechanism, they act together and ultimately result in the systemic activation of the thrombin. And when there is activation of the thrombin, it will result in the generation of the fibrin inside the blood vessels. When fibrin, that is deposited inside the blood vessel, it will result in compromising of the tissue perfusion. As a result of this fibrin deposition and the thrombin deposition, it will further result in the development of a condition that I have pointed out many times in the previous lecture, that is called as disseminated intravascular coagulation. Initially there will be coagulation of the various blood products, but once the coagulation factors, they are utilized, ultimately it will result in bleeding from various body orifices and various body parts, and that is the reason it is also called as consumption coagulopathy. If we talk about the next mechanism that is involved in the pathogenesis of this septic shock, that is the metabolic abnormalities, and one of the very important metabolic abnormality, that is the diabetes mellitus. As you all know, in the patient who have diabetes mellitus, they suffer from insulin resistance and hyperglycemia. And when the patient, he or she is under stress, and when there is widespread inflammation and there is various stress like condition, it will result in generation of numerous hormones, and these hormones, they ultimately result in the gluconeogenesis, that is the formation of the new glucose. So the formation of the new glucose as a result of these stress like condition, and at the same time the suppression of the receptor that is called as glucose transporter 4, both of these, they act together, and it will impair the transport of the glucose across the cell. So it will result in the hyperglycemia. When there is hyperglycemia, it directly affects the function of the neutrophils, and as a result the neutrophils, they are not able to destroy the bacteria, they lose their bactericidal activity, so it further aggravates the shock like condition. One very important example of this is the Waterhouse-Friderichsen syndrome that occurs, that is usually associated with meningitis, or that is also called as that is caused by Neisseria meningitidis, a very important gram negative bacteria. So in Waterhouse-Friderichsen syndrome, there occurs hemorrhages in the adrenal gland or necrosis in the adrenal gland. As a result, widespread inflammatory response occurs that ultimately results in the development of septic shock in the patient. The last important pathogenetic mechanism or the cause of the septic shock, that was the organ dysfunction. In various forms of the organ dysfunction that may be associated with the decreased blood pressure or the hypotension, and those associated with the thrombosis, especially the small vessel thrombosis. But these mechanisms, they will result in decreased delivery of the oxygen to the tissues, decreased delivery of the nutrients to the tissue. As a result, decreased oxygen supply or the decreased supply of the nutrients, there occur the cellular hypoxia, and it may result in the tissue necrosis. One very important example is the cardiac myocytes and or the cardiac contractility that start decreasing when there is decreased delivery of the oxygen and the nutrients, and it may result in the endothelial injury to the vessels if the vessels they are involved. So it will result in the dysfunction of the organ, and once there is involvement of the myocardium, it may further aggravate the condition, resulting in the decreased cardiac output, decrease in the blood pressure, and ultimately aggravating the further shock like condition of the patient. So these were the few pathogenetic mechanisms that are involved in the shock. They are quite important, especially the this pathogenesis of the septic shock that is very commonly asked in the exam, a very important university question. You people just have to give one reading from the book and then remember this diagram, and you have to integrate your previous knowledge of the hemostasis, of the platelet activation and the endothelial injury. Complement activation you people will study in the coming lectures of immunology, so it will be quite helpful for you people, especially this picture, and it will help you especially in the in getting or in writing the pathogenesis of this septic shock. If we talk about the stages of the shock, it is divided into three stages. The first one is the non-progressive phase or the non-progressive stage. Then there comes the progressive stage, and at the end we have the irreversible stage. What happens in the non-progressive stage? Various reflex mechanism, various reflex compensatory mechanisms, they are in activated. The most important reflex compensatory mechanisms, they include the activation of the renin-angiotensin system. That is very important mechanism. Then there is the generalized sympathetic activation. Again, this generalized sympathetic activation, it increases the vascular tone, trying to increase the blood pressure. Similarly, baroreceptor reflex, you people have studied in the physiology, they are also activated, can result in the they can result in increasing in the tone of the blood vessel. Similarly, cutaneous vasoconstriction occurs, the blood vessel of the skin, they constrict. As a result of this vasoconstriction, again it is an attempt to increase the blood pressure to prevent the shock like condition. So these are the various reflex mechanisms that are involved in the non-progressive stage or the non-progressive phase of the shock. Nature has put these compensatory mechanism just to give a compensation for the time being, so that the underlying cause, it can be corrected. But if the underlying cause of the shock that is not corrected, these compensatory mechanism, they will fail and the shock will progress to the next stage or the next phase, that is called as the progressive shock. What happens in the progressive shock? There occur widespread tissue hypoxia, decreased oxygen delivery, decreased delivery of the nutrients, and as a result of all these, there will occur intracellular aerobic respiration that is replaced by the anaerobic glycolysis, and there occurs the excessive production of the lactic acidosis. So eventually, when there is increased production of the lactic acid, it will result in increase in the level of the lactic acids, resulting in the lactic acidosis. When there is acidosis, it will result in decrease in the tissue pH. As a result of decrease in the tissue pH, the arterioles or the blood vessels which were initially constricted, or the cutaneous blood vessels, they were initially constricted, they start dilating. As a result, blood, it starts pooling into the circulation, especially in the capillary. So when capillary pooling occurs, when the blood vessel pooling, especially the pooling of the peripheral blood vessel occur, it will worsen or it will decrease the cardiac output. So it may result in the generalized dysfunction of the organ, and it is here that the disseminated intravascular coagulation that may start, and once there occurs decrease in the blood pressure and decreased cardiac output, it may result in dysfunction of the various other organs, especially the heart, which further aggravates the condition. At this progressive stage, we can even treat the underlying cause of the shock and we can reverse it, but a few deficits or few complications will still remain there after the cause that has been removed. But if the progressive stage, that is again, that is not clear or that is not treated, it will progress to irreversible stage of the shock. What happens in the irreversible stage, there occurs the release of the various lysosomal enzymes, and these lysosomal enzymes, it will cause the breakdown of the various important cells. It will cause the aggravation in the shock like condition. It may result in the bowel ischemia. As a result of the bowel ischemia, the intestinal wall, it becomes thin, and the intestinal bacteria, it may enter the circulation, and ultimately it will result in the development of the septic shock. So all these conditions, they become superimposed. Various conditions, they become superimposed, like if we talk about bowel ischemia, so there will be septic shock. If we talk about heart, it will be the cardiogenic shock. If there will be burns, they may result in the hypovolemic shock, that is superimposed by the septic shock. So the irreversible stage of the shock, it will ultimately result in the death of the patient if it is not treated, especially at the progressive stage level. So these were the various stages of the shock that are associated or that needs to be studied. Apart from the stages of the shock, there are various morphological changes that are seen in the various organs. For example, if we talk about the kidney, there occur a very important change that is called as a tubular necrosis. Lungs may there occur the alveolar damage. When we talk about adrenal gland, there occur the intraalveolar hemorrhages. All these conditions you people will study in the fourth year MBBS when you go to the systemic pathology. They are important there. One important point to mention here is I will show you in the next slide, that are the how will you evaluate a patient clinically, that is she or he is having shock or not. So what are the various signs and symptoms of shock or the shock like conditions? You people will study in detail the clinical features or how to evaluate a shock, a patient having shock clinically. These are the few important signs and symptoms which may help you in diagnosis of shock or shock-like condition. One very important being the weak pulse. The pulse may be weak, it may be rapid and thready. There will be tachycardia or the increased heart rate. The blood pressure will decrease. As a result of all of these three features, there will be profuse sweating, especially from the sweating from the forehead, and there will be the patient may complain of sinking of the heart. Ultimately, the patient may develop renal dysfunctions or the coagulopathy and disseminated intravascular coagulation. One very important feature that is especially related to the septic shock, that is the warm and flushed skin of the periphery, especially of the limbs. And this warm and flushed skin, that is usually present in the initial stages of the septic shock, and it is due to the vasodilation of the peripheral blood vessels. So these are the important clinical features of the shock. So today we have completed a very, very important topic, the shock. You people need to study it two to three times, especially the pathogenesis of the septic shock, and inshallah after that you people will have a good grasp on this topic. So this was all about the disorders of the hemodynamics and the circulation. Next time we'll meet in the lectures of immunology. So till then, take care and Allah Hafiz. And if there is any question, do ask me in your class group, and best of luck for your test also. Allah Hafiz.